Hi, I'm Dr. Damon, and I want to talk to you about the most ubiquitous experience in human existence, and that is pain. I mean, we talk all around it. It is the biggest aspect of our healthcare system, and the most money goes into helping people manage pain. But why is what we're doing not working? I can tell you, after 12 years of working as a doctor of physical therapy, I see patients every day, in and out, who are managing and struggling and suffering through chronic and persistent pain that just doesn't go away. And the most heartbreaking moments are when people come to me and they say, my doctor doesn't know, my neurologist doesn't know. Everyone is telling me they don't know why I'm hurting, and they just want answers and to feel better. So first, I want to tell you, the people who are in pain, who are suffering, and who are looking for help and answers, that it is not all in your head. When they look at scans, MRIs, and images, and x-rays, and psychosocial analyses, and they tell you that there's nothing wrong, we're not living in that space anymore, because what you're experiencing is real. The pain that you feel is real. You're not making this up. So let's talk about how we can really build a foundation on which you can learn to manage and grow and love and experience life with less pain, more joy, and more happiness, right? So if you're a healthcare provider and you're watching this, this is important for you too, because you'll need to take this back to your patients and to your clinics and to your offices, because the studies show that 90% of the medical schools in the United States and in Canada don't have good education, if any, on understanding and treating pain. It's a scary thought, right? It's not that the doctors and the nurses and the therapists and the psychologists and the psychiatrists don't have tools. It's just that we're not all using them the same way, because we're not all functioning on a understanding of how our brain and our experience and our body are managing pain. So let's talk about what this looks like, because there's a certain space in our life that pain lives, right? We used to think that in the big picture of things, the biological part of or aspect of pain is where pain resides. If I stub my toe on a table, then yes, I'm going to have pain in that area, so I need to pay attention to my toe. So if I'm hurting in my arm, then obviously my arm is the area that I need to focus on. And so what do? We give medications, we give therapies, we give modalities, we do exercise to say, work that part of your body out, or give it this medication, and that should solve your pain. Hence the opioid crisis. So we know that that part of it is not really working. It's not meeting all of our needs for pain. What we want to look at is what we call the biopsychosocial model, because it's three parts that really are going to influence how we feel pain and what our experience with pain is. And so let's break that down a little bit. When we talk about the biological part, that's understanding the chemicals in your body, the movement in your body, and how our bodies respond to the influences from the outside world. Hence, pain says there's something wrong with this part of your body. You need to treat it, you need to pay attention to it, and you need to guard it and make it safe, let it heal, and then maybe we'll turn down your pain experience. But a lot of people are not finding relief when we look at it that way. Hence the people who are having chronic or persistent pain, and all of their scans show that they're healthy and they're happy, or should be happy, that nothing's wrong with them. So we also have to look at the other two parts. We're missing two-thirds of this puzzle, and that is the psychosocial part. So when we talk about psycho, that's the psychological aspect of pain. There are amazing psychologists, psychiatrists, social workers, and plenty of people who are helping to manage the psychological part of pain, stress, anxiety, difficulty with how we see ourselves, right? The internal part, the mental health part, if you will, of pain is a real thing. And yes, plenty of people are finding benefit and they're finding some relief in that realm. But let's face it, it's not meeting the needs of most people. And that's why we have to also add in that third part, that social aspect of pain. You see, that space right here in the middle, where the biological meets the psychological meets the social, that's where pain lives. That's where pain is experienced. Because when you're in pain, it doesn't just affect your body. It doesn't just make you make you feel insecure about your body and how it's moving or that you're injured, okay? You don't just feel that physically. You also have psychological issues with managing pain, the anxiety of doing your daily activities, the stress of knowing that your day is going to be filled with discomfort and that you're not going to be able to live as fully as you want to. The social aspect of feeling the need to withdraw from family and from friends and from activities that are central to your life. When we disregard the cultural influence of the pain system, when we disregard the importance of connecting with one another, we find ourselves in a situation where pain is exacerbated, pain raises up, and that pain continues to rise. Now we're dealing with the whole picture of a person experiencing the realities of pain. And so what do we do about this? Now that we have a framework, how do we help people with this framework? And this is particularly for those healthcare providers and for those family members who want to know, well, what do we do if what we're doing is not enough and it's not working? Here's what we do. And this is kind of the philosophy I take as a doctor of physical therapy, but also as a health and wellness coach, helping people who are experiencing pain with no relief or little relief. We have to, one, understand the biological aspect of that pain. How many of us know how pain exists? Do we understand how our body and our mind together kind of create that construct of pain? Do we understand where it, quote unquote, comes from, right? We have to understand how our bodies are wired and what that pain system looks like, because in the end, we're talking about chemicals, we're talking about hormones, and we're talking about the actual physical manifestation of pain in our bodies. And it's important for us to understand what's happening inside us so that we can help to manage it and learn to even control it or reduce it and hopefully abolish it. The second part really attaches to the psychological aspect of it, right? And that really means getting to the root of those things inside of us that are affecting our pain. So becoming more mindful, and I've used this as a blanket term because, let's be honest, the realm of mindfulness is at such a depth that we're still learning so much about it. But we do know, and the research shows, that when we become more attuned with our minds, our thoughts, our emotions, and how it affects our bodies, then we can help to control the pain that is ailing us. It helps us to learn techniques and tools and methods that help us to become more intentional in how we view and see our world from the inside out. And that in turn can help us manage our pain. And so I really give a shout out to those professionals, those counselors, those social workers, those psychiatrists and psychologists, those health and wellness coaches who help people to understand the very important part of managing and learning about how pain is a part of our overall system and how mindfulness can really help with that, okay? The last part is really important, and this speaks to the social aspect of pain, but also is one of the realms that I love the most because it speaks to my own interests and professional space as a doctor of physical therapy, and that is the active lifestyle. And I know we're thinking exercise is the last thing that someone who's in pain wants to do. And that's why I said active lifestyle, because it's so much more about exercise or doing repetitions or lifting weights. Because when we talk about active lifestyle, we have to look at how socially pain has taken us away from the things that we enjoy. It's taken us away from going out and spending time with family. It's taking us away from physically embracing our loved ones. It's taken us away from the activities that make up our lifestyle. So what we want to make sure we do for our people who are really struggling with pain is help them understand and help them manage and learn and organize a lifestyle that is built on them being active and functional. So that doesn't just mean exercise. That means, what is it that really speaks to your soul and your values in life? And how do we get you to physically start doing those things again, so that your body learns that life without pain is not only an option, but but it is your goal. And so when we put all of those things together, now we have such a complete look at how we can treat those of us who are suffering through pain every day. I hope that you've gained a little bit of knowledge and information, and maybe this has opened your mind to how you can be helpful and how you can really ally with people who are really managing pain. And the reality is there's so much more information out there, but we have to start by building a good understanding of what it looks like and what it feels like to not only experience pain, but to overcome pain. So I wish all the health and wellness for you and your families and your practices. And I hope that we can speak some more. Ask me questions. Let's talk about what this looks like, not just on the whiteboard, but in real life. You can reach out to me through my website, thewillpowerwellness.com, or you can shoot me a text message or give me a call. Let's set up a time to figure out how we can fit these aspects in your life or the life of someone you care about so that we can have them move better, feel better, and live better. Be well.